Somewhere along the line, I went from the idea of facing my fears head-on to hiring a legendary noodling guide and entering the world's most famous hand-fishing competition. My objective was to grabble a catfish in order to write a chapter for a fish book from the perspective of a participant. By the time I arrived in Oklahoma, I was ready to thrust my arm down any hole, no matter what lurked inside. I met Skipper Bivens, star of the Animal Planet series Hillbilly Hand Fishing, at Mac's gas station in the small town of Walters, along with his son Christian. I chose their outfit based primarily on two reasons. First, I'd always liked the wise, fatherly character I'd seen on that reality show. Skipper is a burly, jolly, colorful guy who likes to joke around with the city slickers he guides to the gates of hell. And secondly, I like the idea of fishing mostly with my feet rather than my arms in case I needed to scramble for air, which is the technique Skipper's family had perfected through the generations. When we got to the lake, it was overcast out. Like Skipper, I wore long pants and two pairs of socks, no gloves, no shoes, no shirt to get tangled on underwater snags. Skipper slid into the vast, mucky, stump-filled lake, followed by Christian and me. He then led us to the main part of the lake, where we found ourselves swimming if we weren't pushing through neck-deep water. We were constantly crashing into submerged logs and invisible rocks, and at one point, Skipper got hooked on a trot line. We went for miles searching for clay banks, and when we found them, we'd feel around for tunnels that opened into caves. Whenever we'd find one, Skipper would dive down and check the situation out. If there was crumbly stuff in there, that meant the den hadn't been used in a while, or someone had been there before us, so its inhabitants were probably gone. But if the opening was clean and slick, that meant there was a cat in there fanning its tail. "Come here, Mark," Skipper said. "There might be a 70-pounder in here." I went on over and descended into the hole, which was about 5 feet beneath the surface. This took some maneuvering because after going down vertically, I had to go in horizontally, feeling with my feet. Completely submerged, I stopped at my waist. The water was colder in that deep, dark hole, and my nerves were telling me to get out. Still, I figured I could weasel in further, so that's what I did, pulling myself in up to my chest, but I couldn't find a fish at all. I came up and we trudged on to a spot Skipper had marked with a stick. "Oh yeah," Skipper said, "there's one in here, all right." He was sitting down, his head just above the water, and he pulled me right in front of him and sat me on his lap. With his feet blocking the outside of the hole, my feet were poised in the threshold. It was reassuring to have Skipper right there, and was also reassuring to know that I could breathe air and skitch on down. Then suddenly, the fish attacked, chomping down hard on my right foot. I worked my other foot into its mouth and pried its jaws open. I felt them flex to their max, and I knew I had that soccer ball-sized maw in a fully locked open position. "I've got the fish," I told Skipper, who told me to back out until I was in the opening. He dove down and stringered the fish, then wrapped the other end around my hand. The cat blasted straight for the surface, slapping water all over the place. I held on as it freaked out, then pulled it over and hefted it up. It was a blunt-headed, one-eyed blue, pushing 20 pounds. I caught and released two more that day, and the next day we hit the river. Skipper was checking the bank, and Christian and I were flanking him. We kept stepping on random cats and brushing up against carp, which Skipper and Christian sometimes caught just crawling around on all fours. Then we met a cottonmouth, and we all went into an elevated serpent-watching mode. In the meantime, Skipper got a forked stick and pinned it to the sand. Christian then got a piece of driftwood and beat that moccasin to death. 10 minutes later, we found a log half buried in the sand with an active den under it. I slipped in and felt the fish. It was a biggie, and it wanted out, so lunged right into my hands. I immediately got a hold of its head. "Wrap your legs around it," Skipper said. I did that, then worked my fingers down to its mouth. I got a grip on the top jaw with one hand, got the lower jaw with the other, and pried them apart. That fish was totally in my control. I held it as Skipper stringered it. That's when I felt the other fish in the hole. It was also pretty huge. I yanked the first fish out, and it thrashed like a shark attack. a gorgeous golden flathead weighing no less than 30 pounds, pregnant and full of roe. But we still had another cat to get. For a minute or so, it swam back and forth, refusing to bite. Ultimately, though, it ended up in the same spot as its mate, and I got my hands in its mouth. Then there was another eruption. This fish was about the same size, so we had 60 pounds of catfish on the stringer. After the high fives went around, we put the female back, along with tens of thousands of eggs she hadn't yet released, then took off for Paul's Valley. I was the very first of the 113 contestants to arrive at the 15th annual Okie Noodling Tournament. The security guards directed me to the unloading area, where the crowd was hungry to see a big cat. I got it out of the tub and slung it over my shoulder. Escorts whizzed me toward the stage, and there were cell phone cameras held aloft everywhere. I heard my name announced on a loudspeaker, then turned the corner. Suddenly, there were hundreds of people cheering and hundreds more running for the band shell. They were hopping up and down, pumping fists into the air and screaming like I was the Beatles circa 1964. It was such a shocking reception that my jaw actually dropped. Still, their excitement pumped me up even more, and the electricity in the air was like nothing I'd ever experienced before and probably never will again. The judges tagged the fish with a big red number one on a pectoral fin, then took it to the scale. It weighed 29 pounds. The crowd continued going wild, and when I hoisted that fish over my head, the audience exploded again. Later, though, after the pageantry of celebrity noodlers from Nat Geo's Mudcat series, after the bare knuckle babes, and after the 60 pounders, I went over to the demonstration tank to say goodbye to my fish, and was slapped in the face by what I saw. Oblivious children were diving down and grabbing it, then lifting it up to show it off, their grubby little hands pressing into its delicate guts. That's what often kills big fish, which are used to zero gravity. Damage to internal organs from getting manhandled. Not only that, they were stepping on its head as they tried to get to the other fish. A gentle giant, he'd come in scuffed and bloody, resigned to his doom. He knew he was toast, and I knew I was responsible for everything he was feeling now. That's when I saw the underbelly. It came floating by, pale and distended, on the smallest catfish in the tank, noodled to death by fascinated kids. Having bloodied myself in the name of hogging up monster fish, however, I could now make an objective judgment. There was something about the sport that just didn't sit right with me, something about busting into their nests, then yanking them into our cruel world. More than that, though, my recent research had familiarized me with our history of crippling fish populations and thinking it's sustainable. It happened with alligator gar throughout their range, which we're still trying to recover from. It happened with the great white sturgeon crash of the 1890s. And because of dams, paddlefish now need to be stocked for their stunted fisheries to exist. That's what I've been studying. That's what I've been writing about, particularly in regard to our largest freshwater species, whose reproduction is extremely complex. And the fact is, back in the 1800s, flathead cats used to surpass 150 pounds. But these days, there are no 100-pounders anymore. So I got back on the road, that same old road we're always on, and headed back to Arkansas.